Hi everyone, and a very warm welcome. Before we begin, I would like to take the opportunity to wish you a very happy, healthy, and prosperous 2021. Surprise and shock were the two feelings that defined 2020. If in March last year someone spoke about small cap investing, we would have definitely written off the advice. However, as we wrap 2020 and analyze the performance of various indices, small cap has outperformed Nifty large cap by almost 100%. Investors are divided as far as small cap investing is concerned. Some swear by it, some swear it. To understand the various nuances of small cap investing, I am joined by a subject matter expert, Mr. Sameer Raj. He is the fund manager of Nippon India Small Cap Fund at Nippon India Mutual Fund. He has a rich experience of almost close to 3 decades and has worked in various domains. Thank you, sir, for joining in, and I wish you, your family, and everyone at Nippon a great year ahead.
Thank you, Megha, and thank you, Harsh. Thank you for inviting me. I also take this opportunity to wish you and your clients and everybody who is going to see this video very healthy, happy, and wealthy 2021. So thanks.
Thank you, sir. So, sir, before we begin, I would like to, understand this space in the sense that we see the market cap in India, 80% of it is large cap, and less than 5 to 6% constitutes the small cap space. Do you think in times to come, the Pareto principle is going to hold, or do you feel or envisage a future wherein the proportionate share of large cap could fall by 10 to 15%?
Right. So see, historically, if one looks at it, I think small cap space has been roughly about 15% of overall market cap in India, So you're right in that sense that, markets have become quite narrow over the last few years. But I think that has already changed significantly since March. So if one looks at, performance of, say, equal weight indices over the normal indices, so equal weight indices are doing much better than broader indices, which says that, market has really, broadened, So we were passing through economy, which was growing very slowly, and it was a contracting kind of economy. Our expectation is that, markets are going to become broad-based. Economy is also expected to do well. So we expect that, market participation would broaden in the years to come. And, we cannot have the situation where, just 4 or 5 stocks, get most of the return. I think that's not sustainable. So I think it's just a matter of time. It's already happening. And I think it will happen even more aggressively, I guess, going forward.
Right, sir. So, sir, you did answer, a part of my second question, which is that, the general perception has always been that the market is getting extremely polarized, the biggest getting bigger, and, the market leaders in every sector, the top 2-3 companies rule a particular sector outright. Now, in your view, we do understand that it is the balance sheet which is more important than the size of the company. What changes after COVID? Is small cap, sufficiently positioned to take advantage of it, or it could have some problem going forward?
Right. So see, there was a general perception in the month of March, and you say in the month of March people are really worried that small companies are going to go out of business and all that. But I think one will have to understand this, that when one says small cap and the kind of companies which we're dealing with, they're not really small. See, the space has gone significant change, so the quality of company in this space are much better than what they were historically, there are many reasons for that. I think thanks to a lot of reforms which Government of India did in terms of GST, demonetization, etc. Now there is alignment of interest of promoters and investors. So earlier there were cases, there were a lot of fly by night companies, there were a lot of companies, the promoters were taking cash out. But now I think the overall avenues to deploy cash have got limited. So promoters also understand the importance of market cap. And in many companies, what we have seen is that next generation of leaders have come, sons and daughters of the existing promoters, and they're well educated. They understand importance of market cap. They understand importance of corporate governance. So overall, I think quality of governance in this space has improved. Secondly, what had happened that, we were going through significant financial crisis in India. So because of that, most of the companies, they were in a debt reduction mode. So if I look at the companies in my portfolio, overall average debt equity ratio has come down significantly. So frankly, I think that's a perception, and which is a wrong perception, that smaller companies are really vulnerable and all that. And see what happens, in small kept space, you get leaders, many new sectors. So you mentioned in the beginning, they have spent 30 years in the market. So I still remember day, when Infosys came out with the IPO. And Infosys IPO, in fact, was undersubscribed. And Infosys, then went on to become Nifty company over the last so many years. Similarly, I still remember, HDFC Bank, they were first entrants, not first, but they were one of the leading entrants in the private sector banking, which was a new space at the time, kind of. And it went all the way to become India's largest bank today in terms of market cap, kind of. So I think this is a space which gives you opportunity to invest in many of the emerging sectors, kind of. So, it's not that, small is bad. In fact, small is beautiful. That's what our perception is.
So you've given us a great punchline, sir. Small is beautiful. And, you raised very important points of corporate governance and professional management coming in, which ultimately determines the return of equity on most stocks. But the basic problem is that when we meet investors, small cap investing is taken with a pinch of salt. That's a fact, right? The whole perception is that, they would not have sizable balance sheets. Corporate governance could be an issue. Professional management is another issue, etc. Now, do you think that this fear is justified? And could you, for the benefit of our investors, share some leading names in their respective categories, for them to understand that not all small cap can be painted with the same brush?
No. So, I think there are a lot of fears. I'm surprised with the kind of fears which people have about small cap. There are a lot of misconceptions. In fact, I think there are amazing companies. So, I'll give example of Deepak Nitrite. Deepak Nitrite is one of our top holding kind of. So it was considered as an ordinary chemical company many years ago. But, the way they have implemented the phenol project. So I happened to visit their site when this project was going on. And I was extremely surprised. So it reminded me of Reliance site. So many years ago, I had visited Reliance Jamnagar site. And I saw the kind of pace of activity, the kind of similar pace of activity were going on, kind of. And, the number of sheer number of workers which were there on that site and the pace at which they were, implementing the projects and the kind of planning which they had done and the kind of people they had hired as a consultant to do this kind of projects. So, that reminded me of they were at par with any of the India's best names, And, there are many such cases. So, for example, Apple is one company which we have invested. So it's a new generation company, kind of. So, when you interact with Anuj Khanna, you find him a very matured person, I think. He exactly understands, what investors are looking for, what are the opportunities in front of him, how his competitors are doing. And, if he really does well, tomorrow, there are many companies in this space which have become multi-billion dollar companies and all that. They understand. And I think I can give you example after example. There are names like Navin Flory, there are names like Dixon, kind of. So, whenever you interact with the Dixon management, kind of the way they have leapt up, with both hands, this India manufacturing opportunity, I think that will put many of the larger companies also. So, see, this is completely new opportunity. And, whenever the new opportunity comes, the smaller companies, they have this agility to take this opportunity with both hands. So while in case of Deepak Nitrite, the phenol opportunity was available all this while, but Deepak, seized this opportunity and finally implemented the project while a lot of people were just talking, kind of. So in fact, we feel the smaller companies tend to be very agile, kind of. And see, in olden days, when getting funds, where there used to be problems, we had to be dependent on banking system to get the funds, and then you have to be some big corporate house to get money. I think things have changed completely. So, today, to a good quality company, to a good quality business, there are many ways of funding, from private equity to public market and all that. So funds are easily available for good ideas. And in fact, some of these companies, like Baiju and all, without even listing, they have become multi-billion dollar market cap companies. So, if companies like that can become so big, so actually all this fear of small cap being a sort of dirty space, maybe it looks like old, like Bollywood movies of 60s, kind of. I think in current market era, I think those fears are, in fact, you could find that, corporate governance is at par with larger companies. In many cases, even better.
Right, sir. I think probably what you're alluding to and what I understand is stock selection, a bottom-up stock selection is important before you start investing here. So, India is an emerging economy and we expect GDP per capita to increase in times to come. Now, if you see the small cap indices, the universe which is available, we don't have any large names from BFSI sector which have been in this space for a considerable period of time. Now, do you think that is going to be a hindrance in, performance, or, will you always have to resort to names from the large cap space under your allowed limits?
Right. So see, sometimes it helps, all these years, since India was going through a lot of financial crisis kind of situation, debt crisis. So there was no advantage of keeping many of the smaller names in financial services, portfolio. So, last couple of years, we covered our financial service exposure to a large extent through larger banks kind of, which were more solid, which could withstand in all this problems and which can emerge stronger and still grow kind of. So it really helped us cover. So that opportunity was available. But I think going forward, I think many of the smaller banks, which were going through problems, so we feel some of them will come back. In some of the cases, the valuations are very attractive. They've also gone through a lot of changes in terms of system, in terms of the change in focus, in terms of their credit evaluation methods, etc. So some of them will come back. So there will be more choice. And in financial services, there are many new generation of technology-based financial services companies are coming. So, these bank branches and all those things may become more and more less relevant. I would say more and more less relevant. So that's okay. So, so I think there will be many new opportunities which will be coming kind of. So whenever we feel that, in some segment, it doesn't make sense to invest through smaller names. We try and cover it through larger names. And it also helps us managing the liquidity. See, one of the important thing about small cap fund is liquidity kind of. So it's open-ended fund. So, you can get any amount of redemption on any single day kind of. So we have to always manage liquidity pretty well kind of. So what we do, we always try to keep around 8 to 12% of our corpus in a large cap companies without compromising the return. So there are some segments, for example, in oil and gas. In oil and gas, there are no worthwhile companies in small cap space. So if we feel that, oil and gas space is going to make good money, we try and cover that exposure through large cap. So I think we try and manage in such a way that, we manage the liquidity also without affecting the return and opportunity for the investors.
Good afternoon, sir. So taking a leaf from the last question and linking it to macros in India right now. So my question is more about understanding the current stress in the system. So we do understand, sir, this is going to be a recessionary year for us. In fact, the GDP projection by the government agencies is in the range of -7.5% to -7.7% or 8%. And we feel this is going to be the shock after 4 decades or so. Now, when you have this kind of an environment, banks generally become conservative. And we are seeing that also in terms of credit growth, which is not picking up significantly. And we also do understand that for smaller companies, credit is the fuel. And if they don't get that fuel, they can't run. In the light of all this, and since you keep on meeting a lot of managements on a regular basis, do you feel that there are a lot of small cap companies which are having the stress of lack of credit availability? Or you think it's being overplayed by a lot of us who don't understand the space too well?
Right. See, coming to, I think, this GDP growth number. So, we have to understand that, COVID is sort of once in a 100 years kind of event kind of. So it's an extraordinary event in nature. So whatever GDP contraction we have seen is because of the forced lockdown kind of. So frankly, the way that we have bounced back post opening up, it shows the underlying strength of the economy kind of. So I think we feel it's just a matter of time before, growth rate starts improving kind of. And frankly, I think in the world in which we are, it's full of liquidity kind of. And in fact, today, everybody is sitting on more liquidity than they can handle kind of. So in fact, banks are searching for good borrowers. So I think if you have a good business, good borrower and a good promoter, I think money is not a problem. So it's even in a sectors like some of the most impacted sectors, for example, multiplex is one of the most impacted sectors. So even in a sector like this, both PVR and INOX will be able to raise money, from equity markets kind of. So people are, I think investors are over a period of time become mature. If any of your sector goes through temporary problem, they understand that. And so banks could be sometimes risk averse, but I think nowadays, the sources of funding could be far too many. And I think good projects, good business would never face shortage of money kind of. So I think whenever we are interacting with our company, I think money is the last of the like problem. So we, that is, in fact, never come in the mention also. Like that, you know, they're facing problems. So that was a problem last year when some of the like construction companies, they were facing this kind of problem. So banks were not like clearing their projects and, you know, sanctioning them loans and all that. But I think all that is history. So I think even today, I think a lot of construction companies will get money, and we are hearing that, you know, many of this road assets and all are going to be up for sale, and you know they will be able to sell their some of the assets also, and that will also, even in some of the stress sector like construction also, you know, they will be able to get money. So I think that is a wrong perception.
So that's really enlightening, sir, because we do hope that credit offtake starts picking up at a pace at which we want it, because I think that's going to define how we come out of this crisis and how Indian corporates survive. So my next question is about the relative attraction or relative attractiveness of the small cap at this point of time. Though we do understand it was a star of 2020, and the problem in our business is that we start getting interest in a particular asset class basis the historic return. Now, for somebody who's looking to enter small cap at this point of time, is it still sensible and does it still look attractive for a long-term perspective, or one needs to wait and watch for some correction and then try to make move in that?
Right. So see, our view is very clear on this. So, you know, we feel that the way things are going, the chances are there that next decade could be India's decade. So, you know, we have heard this, you know, Indian story that, you know, India demographics and, you know, India potential. And, you know, if you look at per capita consumption data of India compared to any of the emerging countries or developed countries and all, we are at a very minuscule stage. And, you know, we have heard of this J-curve kind of growth for many, many years. But finally, I think thanks to this COVID and thanks to moving global supply chains, etc., and thanks to Government of India. See, Government of, I think there's a big change. What is a big change compared to last several years is that all this while, you know, we had an impression that, you know, government's full focus was not on economy. But thanks to COVID now, and you know, government's significant focus is on economy. Whether you hear Prime Minister, you know, on Independence Day speech, or Finance Minister, or anybody from Finance Minister official and all, I think they're all talking business kind of. And I think government is also very focusedly implemented a lot of schemes like PLI schemes, etc. So we feel finally, you know, that dream of, you know, keeping, making India one of the fastest growing countries coming true. So in fact, you know, next year will be very low base. So on that low base, I think we'll have significantly high double digit growth next financial year. And by that, India could become like the fastest growing country in the world. And I think the way, you know, like the way India is getting importance, like whether it's IT or chemical or even going ahead in the engineering, etc., we feel, you know, next decade could be India's decade. And if that is the case, I think no investor can afford to ignore small cap space, kind of. So, you know, we launched our small cap fund in 2010, kind of. And 2010 to 2020, we completed 10 years. And arguably, you know, that was one of the economically most challenging decade for India. You know, out of that 7 years, we had such a low growth rates kind of. So even in such a bad times, you know, the NAV of our fund has gone from like 10 to 20 kind of, 10 to 50 kind of. So it's 5 times in 10 years. And this is despite one of the like challenging decade for Indian economy. So I think one has to just imagine, like, you know, when India actually, you know, starts realizing its true potential and starts growing at higher rate, you know, what could be the opportunities in this space? So frankly, you know, no serious investor can afford to ignore the small cap space. The only thing is that, you know, how you approach to it is very, very important. So unfortunately, what happens, you know, most of the people, they shy away when it's time to buy. For example, in the month of March, you know, there are extreme values available, but somehow people didn't have the confidence to put money, kind of. So what we feel, I think, you know, as I said, that small cap is roughly about 15% of market cap, overall market cap in India. So at any given point of time, you know, investors should keep at least 15% of his corpus in the space. And if market gives you opportunity and if you have a higher risk profile, you know, then you can increase your allocation. So if somebody is like having zero investment to small cap, or is having less than 15% allocation to small cap, I think you should correct it immediately, like either through lump sum, or maybe you can cover it through, you know, over a systematic transfer over the next 6 months, but keep at least 15%. And, you know, small cap space could be volatile. And if there is a negative news, you know, we could have a significant correction. Suppose tomorrow there's an India-China conflict, which escalates. So, you know, you could have, like, again, discount sale in small cap. So maybe if market gives you opportunity like this, increase the space, increase your allocation. But I think ignoring small cap space is, I think, economically going to be a bad decision.
It's really heartening to hear good things about India, and it's really a great achievement to see NAV going from 10 to 50. And I think a good part of NAV movement has happened in this year also, from March till now.
Right.
And we really hope that in 2030, this becomes 500 and that'll be a way. So my next question, in fact, is very specific to your fund. And since we're discussing the NAV, so I thought I'll ask that question at this point of time. So you manage one of the biggest funds in India as far as small cap is concerned. And not only in India, I was just going through the data points on certain small cap funds in developed market. And they are also having a size of $1.5 to $2 billion is considered to be a decent size. So we also do understand that, the reward of good work at time can become a liability also. So do you think that having such a size and covering more than 100 companies, investing in more than 110 companies at any point of time, does it offer its own challenges in terms of prospective returns? And how do you counter those challenges?
Right. So frankly, this is the question which I'm asked most. A lot of people have this concern about this size. But I think so far, we have never felt constrained because of size. In fact, the way we see it, I think it's an opportunity. So first of all, our size allows us to invest in research, kind of. So small cap is a very research intensive category. I always said that, to buy one small cap company, you have to do research on five, because it's not necessary that, if you like one particular company, you will be able to get the kind of amount of stock which you want immediately. So you have to wait. Sometimes you start buying and stock price shoots up. So, it ends up as a small position. So because of various constraints, I think you need to do research on much more company, and even number of companies in this space are much more. So while there are 100 companies in large cap space and 150 companies in a mid cap space, there are more than 400 companies even between 1000 crore market cap and 9000 crore market cap. So it's a huge space and it's a research intensive space. So one, our size allows us to invest in research. So perhaps we are the only mutual fund which has created a dedicated research team of 4 people only for small cap kind of. So one, the size gives us advantage of investing in research. See, secondly, small cap space, it is a very typical space. So while in large caps, we do top-down investing, whereas in small cap, we do bottom-up investing. So what is our overall approach is, to find out basically good promoters, good business, and, buy them at attractive valuations or reasonable valuations and hold them over a longer period of time. So we have been always asking investors that if you're coming to the space, come with at least 8 to 10 year view. So then only you'll be able to experience the real beauty of this space, kind of. So I think, we don't feel like need to shift, large cap, today he would be very bullish on banking and suddenly he feels that IT is going to do well. So he has to shift their entire allocation to IT, or sometime, he has to shift entire allocation to cement. So how we are approaching is that, using this corpus, how do we create a sort of bouquet of India's best 100 to 110 companies in this space, kind of. And these companies would be diversified across the sector, across the investment style, kind of, so that we don't have to, churn it too fast. So we have to take only those decisions, weed out something which is not working and just hold on, which is, working, kind of. So if that is approach, and if investors who are coming are also coming with that kind of mindset, then there is not a problem. And that is the reason, we by and large in the history of this fund has always taken money through SIP route. And there have been very small periods where we have kept it open for lump sum subscription. The moment we feel that, there are wrong sets of investors, some investors who have short term outlook, it's hot money which is coming, or we feel that, suddenly we are seeing their prospects that, suddenly 2,000-3,000 crores of money will come now, within a period of month, which will hurt returns of long-term investors, we can always stop, kind of. So currently we are not feeling constrained by the size. And I think also, as India grows, so, 6 months, 9 months ago, the small caps used to start at 7,800 crore. So as we are speaking, small caps cutoff is at 9,500 crore. So as we grow bigger, maybe tomorrow, less than 10,000 crore companies will be small cap, kind of. So that universe is also increasing. So I think one is looking at size, one will have to also look at how the base universe is moving, kind of. And I think in small cap, in fact, diversification helps. So I'm not a big proponent of running a very concentrated strategy in small cap. See, because in small cap, both entry and exits have a cost. So I always tell this, you know, in small cap, the game is in your hand till you're bought. So after you're bought, you realize that, you know, something has gone wrong. You have to like maybe mentally ready that you may get less than 50% of what you invested, kind of. So when, you know, the space is having those kind of constraints, if something is going wrong, I think running a very concentrated portfolio becomes a risky. So in fact, looking at the like need of this universe and the kind of investing like style we have, in fact, we have never felt size is a constraint. And at any given point of time, we feel size will be constraint. I think we'll stop in taking fresh money. So I think we are very clear on that.
I totally agree, sir. It makes a lot of sense because generally we track market cap to GDP on a regular basis, but we don't correlate that to the size of the fund. So if market cap to GDP has gone up from 50% to almost, you know, 80-85% in last 8-9 months, then we should also be looking at the fund sizes also in a similar proportion, which we generally don't tend to do.
Right.
And we get anchored to, you know, certain size parameters and we keep on living by that.
Right.
So my next question is, you know, about the behavior of small cap stocks versus large cap. And we do understand that volatility in small cap is very, very high. Tail risk in small cap can be significantly high because, you know, there could be a corporate governance issue, there could be a survival issue and those kind of things, which we generally don't have in large cap. So a large cap investor is generally mentally prepared that even if I am extremely passive in my behavior, at the end of the day, I would not have a bad experience, even if I stay put in a passive way for 10, 15, 20 years. But in small cap, I think some amount of tactical adjustment becomes the order of the day, be it at your end, be it at investors' end. So the challenge which we face in this category is when to book profit. The challenge is when to sell. And a lot of investors have had situations, and as recent as 2018, early 2018, when small cap was shining like anything, and then it had a phase of, you know, a brutal correction. So what would you advise to our investors who are listening this? What triggers to measure? What are the parameters to keep in mind? And when to book profit from small cap?
So it's a very good question. Kind of, if you were to ask me, one of the biggest regrets, you know, in my like career at Reliance Mutual Fund, managing Reliance or Nippon Small Cap Fund, is, you know, not to, you know, we didn't tell our investors to take money out in December 2017, January 2018. In fact, you know, when we launched a fund in September 2010, and between 10 and 30, NAV of a fund had fallen from 10 to less than 7, and from less than 7 to close to 50. So it's almost like 7 times money, you know, in 7 years. So that was a huge amount of return. Kind of, so we had raised cash in our portfolio to around 10-12%, but we never asked investors to take like money home aggressively. So learning from that, you know, what we have learned is that, you know, whenever, you know, so we always tell investors that if you're coming to this space, come with 8-10 year outlook. So whenever your, you know, 7 year plus return, CAGR return starts exceeding 20%, that's a time where you have to start being very, very careful, kind of. And, you know, you should start thinking in terms of when to book profit. So small cap tends to be very volatile space. So, you know, we keep on getting opportunity for some or other reason, kind of. So when you compounded your money at more than 22% for 7-8 years, I think it's a large amount of compounding, kind of. So that is not sustainable. Sooner or later, you know, law of averages will catch up. You know, sometimes what happens, I think this message is very important. So most important word is here that if you're held on for 7-8 years and if you're compounded. Sometime in a year like this, you know, from March, you're already up 100%. So obviously market would correct. So if some negative news comes, the market can correct. But if you start taking profit with, you know, those kind of moves, and if for some reason, correction doesn't come, then, you know, you're left out completely, kind of. So I think one should not be tempted to book profit, too much profit, but a little bit of adjustment one can do. But if, you know, one books profit with short term, one good year, and, you know, then 2 years goes out, and also there's in and out. So you miss a multi-bagger rally, kind of. So, you know, so I'll give you some examples. For example, in a portfolio, in a current portfolio, kind of, we have at least, you know, 7 to 8 stocks which have been multi-baggers for us. For example, Navin Fluorine is one holding. So where our average acquisition price is around 120, and today stock price is whatever. So, you know, it's been 30-40 bagger for us, kind of. So, you know, so... like in this history from 120 to like 2600, Navin Fluorine would have fallen by 50% on more than 5 occasions. So, you know, if you try and book, you know, preempt that and start booking profit. So, you know, again, you have to enter and all that. And chances are very high that, you know, you would have sold your Navin, you know, in between somewhere, and you wouldn't have got benefit of this multiplier opportunities. So I think small cap is a space which gives you that kind of opportunity, and the only condition is that one has to sit tight. So and if one has sat tight, and if he has compounded his money at more than 20-22%, I think that's a time to be watchful. So I think next time we hope to tell our investor when to take money out. But I've been telling in all my interaction to investor upfront that whenever your CAGR return more than 7 years starts going 20%, don't even ask me. You know, just start contemplating that how you want to take money home, kind of. The other important thing is that a lot of investors, you know, come to market with specific goal-based investing. So, you know, somebody has invested money for, you know, daughter's marriage or son's education and all that. So I think those kind of investors, whenever their goals are met, you know, they have to take the money out with discipline. So because, you know, market tends to be volatile. Suppose, you know, so if somebody had invested money for his son's education and, you know, he had a certain target that, you know, whenever my portfolio becomes 15 lakhs, I'll take money out. And now he gets greedy during this time if he doesn't take money out. And tomorrow, say, India-China conflict were to happen. And if that portfolio were again, were to become 7.5 lakh, so then, you know, he would miss that opportunity. So, you know, but if somebody is having surplus cash and one is really looking at making return, I think he should stay invested and he should start thinking of booking profits whenever, you know, long-term returns start exceeding those kind of numbers.
So thank you so much for this explanation, because it's very rare to see money managers talking about redemptions, and that too having regrets about not letting their investors went to redeem. And I think this is the first time in my investing career I would have seen a fund manager talking so proactively about
you know, you make a lot of mistakes. So most of the mistakes, frankly, you know, as a fund manager, what worries me most is the bull markets. Because in bull markets, you know, you tend to make most of the mistakes and you have to pay price then throughout. So, you know, the kind of mistakes which we have made in our portfolio, you know, when we're getting too much money and, you know, in the process, you know, the amount of years we have wasted, you know, we do realize, you know, instead if you would have told our investors, you know, they would be happy investors and, you know, they would be very thankful investors. And whenever times comes back, you know, they will give us more money. We realize that. So, you know, we want to be like a player like that. And fortunately, you know, we have been able to call bottom correctly in the month of March. So we have made a good beginning. So hopefully we'll be able to retain that track record when the real time for selling comes. Right.
We really appreciate, sir. This is really living by the client's interest and living by the investor's interest. So my last question is about active versus passive investing. And the reason why I'm asking you this question is because of two things. One, your fund house is one of the leading passive money managers in the country. And secondly, you know, our conventional wisdom textbooks always used to teach us that small cap investing is all about bottom up stock selection, which you also mentioned in, you know, first few questions when you were discussing about it. But over the last 1 to 1.5 years, we have started also hearing a lot of proponents of passive investing in small cap, and their logic is twofold. One, they feel that covering those many companies is not possible for an active manager. And that's the reason they feel that reason number two, which is diversification, is helpful. So from that point of view, what is your view on active versus passive investing in small cap space?
It's a good kind of. So, you know, I think passive investing is offering like an extra choice to an investor. But I think small cap space is not the most suitable space for passive investing. See, for example, you know, if I look at large cap space, so there's a Nifty. So there are Nifty, there are 50 stocks. So, you know, if in mid cap, there are 150 stocks. But in small cap, like even if we were to take Nifty, small cap 250, you know, there are 250 stocks in that. But if you want to take BSE small cap, I think there are 780 stocks there, kind of. And see, I think what is most important in the small cap is, I think, the quality of promoter and the quality of the business. So I think research plays a very important role. And I think one of the most important thing is that liquidity is not there. See, you know, you can do passive investing in a space where liquidity is aberrant. But you know the kind of liquidity constraints we have in India. So, you know, if out of the 250 stocks, I think there will be at least 60 stocks where, you know, liquidity will be, volumes will be less than, delivery volumes will be less than 2 crore. So, you know, if there are three passive fund managers come to buy together, you know, the kind of impact which would have on price is imaginable. So I think, you know, this passive investing is not a fundamental investing. So while it's going to give us a lot of challenge in the bull market, I think it's also going to give us opportunity. So, you know, sometime, you know, without studying fundamental, if passive money just comes to buy some stock and where we feel that, you know, fundamentals are not that great, you know, we may get good exits thanks to them. So, you know, we'll have to actually learn to take advantage. At the same time, you know, even if something is slightly good and if it's a significant part of, say, benchmark. So historically, we would have ignored it, saying that, you know, theek hai, usko time milega kind of. But nowadays, I think we have to be on our toes. If something is more than 1% of your benchmark, and if, you know, news flows are on the margin turning positive, I think we have to be very watchful and we have to be very responsive. So while it's going to create our own challenge on how we compete with them, but personally, I feel small cap space, thanks to the number of stocks and also thanks to liquidity constraint, is not that suitable. But having said that, you know, having a competition and that too from our own fund house, and they will keep us on our toes. So that's good. Competition is always good.
And that's very relevant. So one of the interesting statements which you made is that active fund manager can take advantage of passive buying something which is not of quality, and you want to offload that, and that becomes an opportunity for you.
Right.
And so with this, we come to the end of this discussion, and there were a lot of learnings for us. So if I have to just summarize key learnings, there were a few revelation which were there as a part of this, that, you know, average debt to equity ratio has come down significantly in India for most of the quality companies. Equal weight indices have done better in last few quarters in comparison to market cap weighted indices. And one of the things which we never realized and which most of us didn't know is that even quality small cap companies are having no issues in terms of the credit availability. And you gave examples of movie exhibitor at that point of time. And one of the things which we learned from you is that, you know, next decade is India's decade. And that is a very positive statement also, because starting the year and starting the decade with a statement which is so optimistic gives us a lot of hope, and which gives us a lot of expectation of India's performance going forward. And last but not the least, your idea about when to book profit, when over a period of 6-7 years, which is a market cycle, if you're making 20% plus CAGR, you should be looking at booking the profit, or when your goals are met, there's no point being greedy and staying put in the market. These are the key learnings for us. And I'm sure, so when our investors listen to this, they would have their own learning. But it was one of the very interesting sessions and very relevant session also, because in last few months, we have seen a lot of queries about small cap, and our advice like you would be that if somebody is looking at this space, look at more as an asset allocation strategy, look at a little longer term view, be an investor and stay put in quality for a long period of time, rather than trying to bring in hot money and take out when you see some profit here and there. Right. So from that point of view, I think this is a very knowledgeable and interesting session for us. Thank you so much for taking out time and enlightening us with your view. And we really hope the performance which you have given in last 10 years would be repeated or even outperformed in next 10 years. Wishing you all the best for your fund, and wishing you all the best for the new year for you, your family, and Nippon India Mutual Fund. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sanega. It's a really great interaction. And you asked really wonderful and very insightful question. There was just one last thing which I want to add, what I realized after interacting with you, that, you know, a lot of people are fearful about the small cap space. You know, it tends to be very volatile. True. And what happens. So I think the most important thing is this amount of allocation you do, however bullish you are on this space, I think investors should not invest more than, you know, 30-40%. Most of the investors, average investor I'm talking about. See what happens, this space tends to be volatile. But say if you put 15% of your corpus, and even if that were to fall by 50%, so, you know, on overall portfolio, you'll be still losing 7.5% kind of. So you won't lose your nerves at the wrong time. See what happens, you know, if people say put 50% of money in small cap and then it falls by 50%. So he's lost 25 rupees and, you know, he's losing his nerves. So, you know, here the most important thing is to take advantage of market fall. And to take advantage of market fall, you have to keep your nerve. So if you do your asset allocation right, then, you know, at the wrong time, you don't end up giving up kind of. So I think that following overall asset allocation discipline is the most important thing. And I'm sure, advisors like you can play a very good role in that kind of. So that's one point. I think if you do good asset allocation discipline, I think then there's nothing to be fearful about the space.
Yeah, that's very relevant, sir. In fact, the entire conversation of yours has been echoing around discipline, has been echoing around fundamentals and about asset allocation. And that's really something which we also believe in, because we feel that our biases can play a lot of negative inferences, or they can interfere with the portfolio allocation. But if we are mathematical, if we are going by models, if we are doing asset allocations by the profiles of the client, then the chances of going wrong reduces significantly. And we don't have those bad days when somebody needs money and the money is coming at a discount to him, which is not a fair situation.
Right.
With this, so we end this discussion. And once again, thank you so much. And thanks entire Nibon team for organizing this at a very, very short notice. And wishing you all the best for the coming year.